Well, good evening, everyone. It is really an honor and a joy to be here with you folks this evening through this avenue, this means of taping and recording. I trust that what we share with you here this evening from God's Word will be a blessing to your heart. I appreciate Pastor Joel and him giving me the opportunity to come and share God's Word with you. This is still new to many of us, preaching through this type of avenue, somewhat awkward and a little difficult, but we're learning as we go, and we're praying that God will use this message tonight to be a great encouragement and help to your heart. If you have your Bible handy, would you please join me tonight in the book of Genesis, chapter 18? We're going to read verses 10 through 19 in just a moment. And I'd like to share some thoughts with you this evening about the Lord's doings. I realize that we are facing some very difficult and unprecedented days here right now in our world, our country, our state, our city, with the COVID-19 and our response and all that we're doing to try to combat it and stay safe and protected, to keep as many people well and healthy as we possibly can. These are really unusual days. I cannot think of a time in my past life that we've experienced anything like this. And so it's all new and it's different. And we realize that right now people are getting a little edgy and wanting to start getting out of the house, getting back to work, and those things are needed and good. And hopefully soon here we'll see that transpiring. But it is important that while we are facing this, while we're going through it, that we're learning from the Lord and that we're allowing God to teach us and remind us the truth and the power of His Word in our lives every day. So let's talk tonight about the Lord's doings. We'll see an example of it here in Genesis chapter 18 in the life of Abraham and Sarah and God's promises to them. I'm going to begin reading at verse number 10. It says this, "And he said, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life, and lo, Sarah, thy wife, shall have a son. And Sarah heard it at the tent door, which was behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old and well stricken in age, and it ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. Therefore Sarah laughed within herself, saying, After I am waxed old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord being old also? And the Lord said unto Abraham, Wherefore did Sarah laugh, saying, Shall I of a surety bear a child, which am old? Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the time appointed, I will return unto thee according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son. Then Sarah denied, saying, I laugh not, for she was afraid. And he said, Nay, but thou didst laugh. And the men rose up from thence and looked toward Sodom, and Abraham went with them to bring them on the way. And the Lord said, Shall I hide from Abraham that thing which I do? Seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him, for I know him, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord, and do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him." On several different occasions, God had already assured Abraham that he and Sarah would have a child. Back earlier, a few chapters here in the book of Genesis, God had given that promise to them. And now here, a little bit later, the promise comes, and then there'll be another promise coming. Actually, the promise takes 25 years to actually be fulfilled before Isaac is born. That's a long time to wait upon a promise. And I would wonder sometimes how reliable that Abraham and Sarah were with their faith and resting in God for that promise. I'm sure they were much like you and I. There are points in our life where we doubt and we wonder and we think, well, is God really going to do what he said he was going to do? But we learn from the passage of Scripture here that this promise is given. We know from history the promise was kept. And we know upon the authority of God's Word that he's always truthful, and whatever he has promised, that he will do. But yet Abraham and Sarah did have a point in time where they ran ahead of God, and because of that, Ishmael was born. You know, sometimes if we're not careful, we too will run ahead of God and not wait patiently upon God's direction and what God has told us he would do. But now here in chapter 18, the Lord pays a personal visit upon Abraham, his servant. And in this time that they are visiting together, once again, the Lord assures Abraham and Sarah that this promise is real, that it will take place, that it will come about. The Lord's doings are always, always real. The Lord's doings will always be honest and truthful. Whatever God has promised, He will see to it that it is carried out. I'm reminded of a verse in Psalm chapter 118 and verse 23. It says this, "This is the Lord's doings. It is marvelous in our eyes." Aren't you glad for the promises of God that you see fulfilled in your life? Aren't you glad when you see God keeping His word? Aren't you glad for the different needs that are supplied on your behalf? God always, always keeps His words to His children. Abraham and Sarah are learning that. They're going through a process of learning that the Lord always keeps His word. I'd like for us to notice a few things here in Genesis chapter 18 that reminds us about the Lord's doings and how He brings things about and why He does so. Notice with me in verse number 10. Notice here is the Lord's promise itself. Verse number 10, the Lord said this, "I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life, and lo, Sarah, thy wife, shall have a son." What a promise. Notice the phrase that is used over and over and over again in verses 10 through 32. Two little words, "I will." I will, he used it here in verse 10. "I will certainly return unto thee." I will. That's the assurance of God's promise. God did not just say, "I'm going to do this." Over and over again, he repeated, "I will. I will. I will." It's the authority of God's word in those two little words. "I will do this." Thank God for all of His promises. Every promise in the Bible is secure. Every promise in the Bible is true. Every promise God will fulfill. Many He has already fulfilled. And those that have not yet been fulfilled, they will be. We have the "I will" of the Father to accommodate us for that. As you think about the promises of the Lord, think with me for a moment about the promise of salvation. What a wonderful promise that is. The Bible reminds us in Romans chapter 10, verse 13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." What a promise. Shall be saved. I'm grateful for the moment in my life where I came to know Jesus Christ as personal Savior. I was 18 years old and was raised in a Christian family, but yet through my high school years, I questioned whether or not I was truly a born-again believer, and God finally got a hold of my heart one evening when I was 18 years of age, and I trusted Christ to be my personal Savior. I claimed that promise in Romans 10, 13, and I'm just as sure of it today as I ever have been that I know Christ in a personal way. Thank God for the promise of salvation. If you have not done that in your life at this moment in time, I trust that you will. Knowing Christ in a personal way is the greatest thing that you could ever know, because you have Him living in your heart to guide you and help you each and every day, as well as prepare you a home in heaven for some time in the future. Do you know Christ? Here's the promise of salvation. You also in the Bible have the promise of answered prayer. The promise of answered prayer. The Bible tells us this in Jeremiah chapter 33, verse number 3, "Call unto me, and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not." What a promise to answer prayer. God has promised to answer our prayer. Now, don't misunderstand, because sometimes people think, well, if I ask God for ABC, then God's going to give it to me just like I want it, ABC. But you realize it's God answers our prayers in several different ways. Sometimes He just simply says yes, and we get the petition, the request that we ask for. Sometimes God gives us a different answer than what we are anticipating or what we've even think is the real need that we have, and God will sometimes give a different answer. Sometimes God says, you're going to have to wait. The timing is not quite right, and we have to be patient upon God until God provides exactly as He would want to provide for us in that particular request. And then sometimes God simply says no. And I have learned that no is just as much of an answer as yes is an answer. But here's the promise of prayer. And God has promised to answer all of our prayers. And third, there is also the promise of the second coming of Christ. Jesus said in John chapter 14, I will come again. The I will in John 14 is just as secure as the I will here in Genesis chapter 18. He's made a commitment. He is coming again. We also have the promise of his presence. He said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. He said, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. I'm glad for the eternal, sweet presence of God in my life every day. Here we are at a particular juncture in our history where many of us are wrestling over some different things and concerned about different things going on in our country, in our nation, concerned about the coronavirus and all of its effects that it's having around us. I'm glad we can enjoy the presence of God to give us peace and joy and comfort and help and strength in these particular times that we are facing. Now, there are several things we should understand about God's promises. First off, God's promises are based on his character. The Bible says, God says, I am holy, therefore be ye holy. And God says he is a holy God. And because he is a holy God, he cannot lie. Therefore, because of his character, he will always keep his word. We also need to understand that some of God's promises are conditional, while some promises are unconditional. For example, salvation, the promise of salvation, that's conditional. It's conditional upon you doing one thing, believing. The Bible says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. It's not the condition of living the best you can. It's not the condition of going to a particular church. It's not the condition of changing your lifestyle and mannerisms around to something that is better. The condition is to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and then you would be saved. The verse I shared a moment ago, Romans 10:13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. To call, that means to ask. That means to receive Christ, to believe on him. That promise of eternal salvation in Christ is conditional. But yet the promise of eternal security after we get saved, that's unconditional. When you get saved and come to know Christ as personal Savior, you are secure in him forever. Nothing can revoke it. Nothing can change it. Nothing can take away from it. You are saved and secure in Christ. The promise of eternal security is unconditional. The promise of the second coming of Christ, I mentioned a moment ago, that promise is unconditional. He's coming again, period. Nothing can thwart it. Nothing can stop it. He's coming again. Some promises are conditional. Some promises are unconditional. And then again, we need to understand that God's promises should be claimed by the believer. We should claim his promises. We should simply take God at his word. The life verse of my dad is a verse that is well known by many believers today. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. My dad loved that verse. He claimed that promise. He rushed upon that passage of scripture every day of his life. He learned how to trust the Lord and learned how to rest upon God and claim the promises to the believer. We should do likewise, because if we fail to claim God's promises, we will be the ones who are missing out on God's best blessings for our lives. Rest in God. Take him at his word. Here in verse number 10, we see something about the Lord's promise. God made a promise to Abraham and Sarah. I will come unto thee. I will return unto thee. God is going to keep his word. Now, we also learn something else here in verse number 10 about the Lord's doings. We learn something here about the Lord's pleasure. The Lord's pleasure. Look at verse 10 again with me. It says this, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life, and lo, Sarah thy wife shall have a son. Do you know God delights in doing good things for his children? He enjoys it. I enjoy doing things for my family. I enjoy doing things for my kids. I was coming home from work just the other morning, and I decided that I would stop and pick up something for breakfast. They hadn't asked for it. Nobody had sent me a text message. I didn't get a request from my wife. I picked up some cinnamon rolls from work and put them in the car, and I got in the car and drove home. I decided to make a stop at one of our local drive-thrus and take home some breakfast sandwiches and bring them home to my family and enjoy, just because I wanted to. I enjoy doing things for my family, just like you do. Well, God enjoys doing good things for his children. He takes pleasure in it. He delights in it. Let's go to a few different verses of Scripture. Let's go to the book of James. James chapter 1 and verse number 17. Here's what the Bible says. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. God delights in giving good things unto his children. Let's go to the book of Ephesians. And notice with me the book of Ephesians in chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3. And let me read verse number 20 for you. It says, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. God can do all things, and he delights in doing all things for his children. I'm going to go to the book of Acts, chapter 10, and notice a verse here that sometimes gets tucked away and we kind of overlook it, but chapter 10, the book of Acts, and verse number 38, it says this, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Everywhere Jesus went, Jesus was doing good. I'm glad that the Lord takes pleasure in doing good things for his children. It was his pleasure to give Abraham and Sarah a son. It was his pleasure to give Hannah a son named Samuel. It was his pleasure to give Abraham on top of Mount Moriah a ram to put in place of his son Isaac. It was the pleasure of God to give Elijah food by the brook Cherith and then also in the town of Zarephath. It was the good pleasure of God to give Isaac the lovely bride, Rebekah. It was his good pleasure to take blind Bartimaeus and give him his sight. It was his pleasure to take a small boy's lunch and feed 5,000 people at one time. It was the good pleasure of the Lord to take the maniac of Gadara and to set him free from bondage and give peace to his tormented soul. It was the good pleasure of God to take Daniel and deliver him from the mouth of the lion. It was the good pleasure of God to take the widow in Luke 7, whose son had died, and restore him to life once again. And it was his good pleasure to take the lost and dying world and give himself as the sacrifice for our sins and make the one-time atonement payment for you and me so that we can know Christ in a personal way. That's his good pleasure. Aren't you glad the Lord does good things for us? He did so with Abraham and Sarah in providing a son by the name of Isaac, the Lord's pleasure. And the Lord wants to continue doing good things for you and me. Oh, I know here in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic that we look around us and wonder, is God doing anything for us? Is God supplying the needs for us? What's going on and where's God? And sometimes we wrestle with some of those questions. But I want you to know of a surety that God is doing good things for his people today. God is continuing to take care of us. God is continuing to supply for us. God is continuing to give us the resources necessary for us to have a life that will be pleasing unto him. The Lord's good pleasure. There's something else we learn here in Genesis 18. It's found in verse 14. It's a reminder to us of the Lord's power. The Lord can do good things for us because of the Lord's power. Here in chapter 18, verse 14, notice what the Lord said back to Abraham and to Sarah. Is anything too hard for the Lord? Is anything too hard for the Lord? That really is a rhetorical question because it has an obvious answer to it. The answer is no, there is absolutely nothing too hard for the Lord. He is God. He is the Almighty. He is the Supreme One. He is the Holy God of heaven. And he is capable of doing all things for you and for me. The Lord's power. It's demonstrated over and over again throughout the Bible. It was through his power that he actually framed the universe. It was through his power that he destroyed the earth in the day of Noah. It was through his power that Israel crossed over the Red Sea, survived the wilderness, and eventually conquered the land. It was through his power that David defeated Goliath, that Nehemiah rebuilt the walls, and that Elijah saw the fire from heaven fall. It is through his power that a young virgin girl brought forth the Son of God. It was through his power that the sick were healed, the dead were raised. It is through his power that God's Son was brought forth in resurrection splendor. And it is through his power today that the church was born. Missionaries are sent out and souls are being saved. All of it by the power of the Almighty God of heaven. And whatever need that you have today, whatever it is that you are suffering, whatever it is that you are wrestling with, whatever the questions are, God has the ability and the power to settle it all. He is God. And just as he was at the edge of the Red Sea when Israel was backed up against it, God is at the edge of your life today. And he will assist you and help you and carry you safely to dry ground on the other side. Rest in the Lord today. Know that his power is there. His power is available for you and for me. And God's power is the same just today as it was yesterday. Remember, the Bible says Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. God's power has never been thwarted, and it will not be thwarted today. Trust him. Trust him when your heart is breaking. I could share with you a number of close personal examples, people that I know. We have two dear ladies in our church right now out in Coatesville who are suffering cancer. I'm so glad they can know God's power. I have a dear friend who has been battling the coronavirus himself personally. But God is helping him and God is assisting him. I'm glad for God's power in his life. I have a dear friend that I just visited the other day whose father was at the point of death. I received word just a day or two ago that his father passed on and is in heaven today. And I know their heart is breaking. But God's power is real. And God can give them exactly what is needed to carry them through this situation in their life. And God will do the same for you. God will do the same for me. Because of God's power, when our heart is breaking, he will be there to mend it, to lift us up, to help the burden, to ease the pain as we walk through that journey. Again, I can trust him to supply all of my needs. Some of you are probably without work. Some have been laid off. Some are struggling financially because income has been lowered, because work has almost ceased here because of the coronavirus. But I want you to know the same God who was supplying for you a month or two ago is the same God who can supply for you today. He has not changed. Oh, some of the situations in life change, but God never changes. And if God took care of you yesterday, God will take care of you today. Trust him and rest upon him. It's all because of his power. We can also trust him to give us personal victory in our walk with him. As Satan tempts and Satan creates struggles in our hearts and our minds, it is the Lord, because of his power, that can help us to be victorious over all those questions and temptations of life that may come across our path. It is God's power that we must rest on. It is God's power that we must depend on. He will see us through. There is something else we learn here in Genesis chapter 18 about the Lord's doings. It's found in verse number 19. Here's what the Lord said. For I know him, that he will commit his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, and the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him. Here is the Lord's personal attention. Do you notice the first few words in verse number 19? They are sweet. They are precious. They are encouraging. The Lord said of Abraham, for I know him. Wow. Aren't you glad that God is personal? Aren't you glad that God knows us? He knew Abraham, and just as he knew Abraham, he knows you, he knows me, he knows us in a very deep and personal way. In fact, God even knew the testimony of Abraham, knew that he would lead his family in the right direction, knew that he would obey the Lord and keep the faith and keep his truth. In that simple phrase, the Lord is simply saying, I know his heart. I know his heart. I know how Abraham will operate. I know how Abraham will do. Is he saying Abraham was perfect? Well, no. No, we know Abraham is not perfect. Abraham certainly had his failings. But yet God knew his heart. God knew him. God knew what he was capable of. God knew how he would respond in all situations. God knows his heart. And God knows you and me. And reminds us throughout his word that he's there to assist and help and care. Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. You. It's just that personal. He cares for you. Aren't you glad about that? That should cause your heart to rejoice. That should make you rise up and shout glory unto God. Because he knows you in a very personal way. God is not just some type of inanimate force that is somewhere way out there in the university. No. God is out there and he knows us in a personal way. He's real. He's genuine. He cares all about you and me. Thank God for his presence in our lives. Thank God for the authority of his word. I'm going to turn to Psalm 139 for a moment. Here's a sweet reminder that the Lord is with us and that the Lord knows us. He understands us. He's there to care for us and in the journey of life. He said this in Psalm 139, O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my downsitting and mine uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. Thou compassest my path and my lying down and art acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind and before and laid thine hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain unto it. Whither shall I go from thy spirit? Whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost part of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me. What a precious promise. He knows all about us. He knows us. He knows our heart. The Lord has personal attention on each of us. I will admit, I don't understand how God can keep track of every single one of us all the time like that. But remember, he is God. He has all power, all ability. He can do all things because he's God. The Lord's doings. The Lord's doings. Perhaps in our praying at this particular time, perhaps we should be asking God for something besides just our daily needs and safety and protection from the coronavirus and for our friends who may be suffering for a number of different reasons. Perhaps we should also be including in our prayers, God, would you please do something here in this that will demonstrate who you are and that you are at work and that it's the Lord's doings in bringing us through. I don't think it's wrong to pray that way because we want God honored and glorified in all things, even in this situation. And we need to be praying much. But we also need to be resting much on the Lord's doings. He is at work in our lives. He is at work in your life. Allow God to help you. Trust him today. Rest in him today. He will not fail. He is there for you. Father God in heaven, thank you for our time together in your word today. Thank you for loving us the way you do. Thank you for the promises of your word. Thank you, Lord, for having all power in heaven and earth. And thank you, Lord, for caring about us in a personal way. Lord, help us, we pray, meet the needs of our hearts. Thank you for this dear church, and thank you for its dear pastor. Bless them, Father. Watch over them and care for them. Meet every need that they have. And, Father, we'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.